All right, are you ready? Buckle up. Give you some quizzes today. Not real hard ones. How old was Abraham when Isaac was born? 100 years old. Now, the Torah portion this morning, as you can see on the screen, is Toldot. And what does Toldot mean? Not exactly. Okay, so let me come here. For some reason, this isn't working, so we'll go like this. Okay, it says generations in everyone's Bible, but that's another correction that Danny and I are making. The Hebrew word for generations is the word dor. All right? What is the difference? I mean, you know, sometimes when you go from one language to another, you don't have a word for it, and you have to kind of, that's why the Amplified Bible tries to amplify things to get a greater meaning. But Toldot is more. It is not just the lineage, but the history. And so just like grandma or grandpa sits down and tells you all about Uncle Bob or whatever it is. So here we have the story of Abraham's going to be dying, Shem's going to be dying, you know, all of the stories. So that's really what generations or what Toldot means. It's not just the lineage and the history, but it's the stories. Or a good word that really isn't a good word is the whereabouts. What happened? So that word Toldot means the whereabouts. Where did they go? What did they do? The history. Now, one of the reasons I bring this up, and many of you are aware of this, when we started in Genesis chapter 2, verse 4, where it says these are the generations of the heavens and the earth, we had the word Toldot. And these two vavs here, this is the T-O-L-D-O-T. That would be the comparison in the English. But then in Genesis 5:1, it talks about this is the book of the Toldot of Adam, but there's a letter missing. The second vav is missing. And so it would be like that, where the second O is missing. And you don't see these things in English. That's the problem. It's amazing when you see it in Hebrew. Now, in case you didn't know, in the Bible, in every Torah, the word Toldot is spelled wrong another 70 times in the Torah. It's never spelled correct again. So that means something's happened. Well, that letter Vav, what does it mean? What does the letter, every letter in Hebrew is also a word, okay? And so what does the vav symbolize? Oh, in English, it's the word and. It's a connecting, like a nail connects to boards. The vav connects two words, this and that. Well, because it's a connection, when God made everything at the beginning, it was perfect. But in Genesis 5, Adam sinned and the connection is broken between heaven and earth. Okay, so now when are we going to see the connection restored? The word Toldot is not spelled correctly again until the book of Ruth, when it talks about the generations of Perez, and he is the one who begets David. It goes through the list, and all of a sudden, when David is introduced, we see the connection to heaven and earth has happened again. Why? Because David is born. And this is why in Matthew chapter 1, when it talks about the Toldot of Yeshua, it begins with the son of David, not Adam, not Noah, not anybody. It's David. Why is it with David? Because the Messiah is going to be the son of David. He's the Messiah. Well, look at this. This is what is so misunderstood by many Christians, because they don't understand the vav, the connection to the Hebraic roots. In Matthew 1:17, it says all the generations from Abraham to David are how many? 14. From David to the carrying away are how many? And from the carrying away to the Messiah are how many? Okay, we'll get a load of this. Here's the first letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Can anyone tell me what the first one is? Aleph, Bet, Gimel, Dalet, Hey, and Vav. Every letter in Hebrew also has a numerical value. Like A would be 1, Z would be 26, because there's 26 letters. All right, so these are the first six letters. But notice the D and the V. The way you spell David is a Dalet, a Vav, and a Dalet, which equals 14. So when Matthew is saying 14, 14, 14, someone who knows Hebrew is going to read David, David, David. This whole thing is about proving he is the Messiah, the son of David. Now, let's go to Genesis 25, 7, which was from last week's Torah portion. But it said, Abraham lived to be 175 years old. So if Abraham is 175, how old is Isaac when Abraham dies? 75, right? How old is Isaac? Let's take a look here at Genesis 25, 19 and 20. We know Isaac was 75. And now it says, these are not the generations of Isaac, but these are the stories of Isaac, Abraham's son. And we see that Isaac was 40 years old when he got married to Rebekah, who was the sister to Laban. Well, in Genesis 25, 26, here Isaac and Rebekah have these two kids. And it says that after that, his brother came out, his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. And then we see that Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah bore them. Okay, if they got married at 40, they have twins at 60, she was barren 20 years, right? Everyone follow me. Okay, now, how old is Abraham when Jacob and Esau are born? Okay, well, if Isaac was 60, Abraham was 160. Okay, but then what do we find? That Isaac was 75 years old when Abraham died. And so therefore, 75, we see Jacob and Esau were 15 years old. You following me? 15 years old. But you know what is amazing? Shem was still alive for another 35 years after Abraham died. The guy that was on the boat. So get a load of this. Isaac knew Shem for 95 years. Can you imagine? Shem is telling Isaac for 95 years all about the flood, being on the boat, how the whole world was devastated. Well, Jacob and Esau knew Shem for 50 years. Even Jacob and Esau, they got to talk to Shem. They knew about the destruction of the flood first hand. As a matter of fact, if you look at Genesis 9, 28, 29, Noah lived after the flood another 350 years, and all the days of Noah were 950 years. That means Abraham knew Noah for 58 years. Abraham knew both Noah and Shem. Now, talk about getting a firsthand view of what happened during the flood. And I think this is one of the reasons why Abraham believed in God. All right? It's not like he just got struck out of the blue. There must be another God. But Abraham got to talk to Noah. And if you look at Genesis 11, 10 and 11, where it talks about the generations or the stories of Shem, we see 2 years after the flood, when Shem was 100 years old, he had Arphaxad. And then it says Shem lived after he beget him another 500 years. Wow, so he lived 500 years after the flood. Now, let's see. Genesis 25, 21 through 23. Here we see Isaac is entreating the Lord for his wife because she was barren. And Rebecca conceived, and here she has these two kids struggling within her, and she says, why is it this way? And so she went to inquire of the Lord. Where did she go to inquire of the Lord? Shem is still alive in Jerusalem. He's the king of Salem, the king of Jerusalem. He's the one who knew about the flood. That's where she goes. And that's where she found out that there were two nations in her body. Now, one of the interesting things that some of you might think this is interesting, it was Rebekah, not Isaac, who received the word concerning God's choice of Jacob over Esau. It was Eve, not Adam, who received the prophecy concerning her seed. It was Sarah, not Abraham, who correctly discerned God's choice of Isaac over Ishmael. It was Miriam, Yeshua's mother, not Joseph, who receives the angelic word first. Just kind of fascinating. Now, in Genesis 25, verse 27 and 28, it talks about Jacob. Oh, yeah. Jacob and Esau are growing. Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field. But Jacob, now one translation says he was a plain man. Another one translation says he was a homely man. Another translation says he was a quiet man. Well, the Hebrew word is tamei, and it means he was truthful. He was a blameless person without blemish. But it says he dwelt in tents, whereas Isaac loved Esau because of how he cooked. The first male chef. Now, look at Genesis 25, 31 through 33, Jacob says, sell me this day your birthright. And Esau said, behold, I'm at the point I'm about to die. What profit will this birthright do to me? And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he swore to him and he sold his birthright to Jacob. All right, there's a lot of interesting things, and I'm going to bring up this chart. If you guys want to take pictures, feel free to take pictures. But this is an Isaac timeline of some things I want to bring out of how old everybody was for a couple hundred years as things go by. But let me point this out in particular. Isaac is 110 when Shem dies. Esau, he has a family because Esau got married at 40 years old. Jacob doesn't have a family. And this is when Esau sells the birthright, and they're 50 years old. So at the selling of the birthright, Jacob and Esau are 50 years old, and that is when Shem dies. And the thing about the bread and lentils, that is what they eat at funerals. Forever, Jewish, it was they were having a memorial for the death of Shem, okay? It's the food, okay, the meal of condolence. And look at this. What did they eat? Bread and lentils. It's been forever that way. So when you understand the connection, you realize when he's selling the birthright, it's because Shem has died. Who inherits the birthright from Shem? So this is huge. But the amazing thing is, Esau has a family, and he doesn't care about passing it on. He just cares about himself. Jacob, who has no kids, sees the importance of the priesthood coming from Melchizedek, as well as the kingship. And so Isaac is already 110 years old. But get a load of this. Shem was Isaac's great, 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 great grandpa. And he was still there. Now, in Genesis 14, verse 18 and 19, we hear about Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine. He was a priest of the Most High God. So we see he is both a priest and a king. Now, within Judaism, you can't be both priest and king. Judah is the king, Levite is the priesthood, but in Zechariah, it talks about Messiah coming, and he will again be both priest and king. It's coming back. Now, I believe Jacob also attended the school of Shem. I believe part of his life, he also went to Jerusalem and he learned from Shem. In Exodus 19:6, we see that all of Israel was to be a kingdom of priests. So here you see kingship and priesthood. But what happens? We had the problem where they didn't want to hear from God. And so Genesis 26:34, we see Esau was 40 years old. And who did he marry? He married two Hittites. The Hittite, the definition means terrorists. He married into terrorist families, two different ones. And it says they were a bitterness of spirit to Isaac and to Rebekah. All right. So let's look at Genesis 26, 1 through 5. Going back, and here we see there was another famine, like the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, and the Lord appeared to him and said, "You, I don't want you going down into Egypt. Stay here. I'll be with you. I'll bless you into your seed. And I'm going to give you all these countries." And then look at this. "I will perform the oath which I swore to Abraham, your father. I will make your seed to multiply as what?" That's a lot. How many of you can count the stars? And he says, "I will give to your seed all of these countries. And in your seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed because Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws." Wait a minute. Moses wasn't for 400 more years. So how can you tell me Abraham kept God's commandments and statutes and Torah? Wow. Because Abraham heard God's voice and God told him. Even Adam and Eve kept the Torah. Now, not all of it, but what God, the Torah was from the beginning. That's why the first, what was the first commandment of the Torah? Don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. When we think Torah, we have to think in terms of rules that God gives mankind. And so here, that was the first rule, actually, of God's word. Don't do this. Adam and Eve knew the difference between clean and unclean, even. This is why when Cain and Abel and they did sacrifices, God did not want unclean animals to be sacrificed. Okay, so they always knew a whole lot of the Torah. Okay, so now let's look at Genesis 26, 12 through 15. Isaac sows and he reaps in the same year 100 times what he planted. Can you imagine in a time of famine when everyone's crops aren't doing anything and you're getting 100-fold? You're going to stand out. The Lord blessed him. He grew great. He grew more and more until he became very great. He had possessions of flocks and herds and households. So what happens? The Philistines envy him. Now, you want to see how stupid the Philistines are? I mean, stupid is as stupid does. Here, they're having a famine. And what do you want when there's a famine? You want food, but water. Well, look what they did. All the wells which Abraham's servants had dug in the days of Abraham, his father, the Philistines, stopped them and filled them with dirt. Why would you be so stupid? Why not just take over the wells? Why fill them with dirt? Sometimes envy can drive you to do really stupid things. And just like recently, when Israel left the Gaza Strip in 2005, they had all of these things that they could use. And what did they do? They tore it down and sold the copper, and they ruined everything that they could use to bring in income. All right. And not only that, if there's a famine, you want your livestock to live and they need water. Why in the world would they fill them up with dirt? Well, so then Genesis 26, 16 and 17. And you have to remember, this is the Abimelech that knew Abraham and Sarah. And he knows that Abraham is a blessed individual. And so he tells Isaac, Get out of here, because you're much mightier than us. How stupid. If I had someone that was successful, I would stop and ask them, well, how can we be successful too? Instead of driving them out, I'd say, work with me, help me. It's pride that is what brings a lot of prejudice. So what does Isaac do in Genesis 26, 18? He goes and digs again the wells of water which they had dug in the days of Abraham, because the Philistines, you know, had filled them with dirt after the death of Abraham. And then look at this. He calls their names after the names by which his father called them. He renames them what dad did. Well, guess what? I believe what you guys are doing right now, reinvestigating and digging into the ancient roots, is just much like Isaac's journey going back to the wells of his father. The original sources have been hidden and buried from us, but as Gentiles, we're now digging into the Torah and we're opening up those wells of living water that we're finding right there. And so the Torah is also likened to a well of water, and it also has been hidden from us and filled with dirt. And you guys are doing exactly what Isaac is doing. You're redigging Abraham's wells. You're not trying to dig new wells, which is what replacement theology does. So here in Genesis 48:10, it says the eyes of Israel were dim for age so that he couldn't see, and he brought them near to him, and he kissed them, and he embraced them. And so here we see Isaac, his eyes were dim. Well, guess what? Jacob's eyes were also dim. I want to bring this out in Romans 11:25. This is a very important principle. Paul says to the Christians, I would not, brothers, that you would be ignorant of a mystery, lest you be wise in your own conceits, but blindness in part has happened to Israel. Israel is not totally blind. Isaac's eyes were dim, but he wasn't totally blind. And Israel isn't totally blind. It's only happened in part. And we know in 1 Corinthians 3, 13, 12, it says, as Christians, we only see through a glass darkly, okay? And now I know in part. So the Christians see through a glass darkly and know in part. We're partially blind, and the Jews are partially blind. And the first group to humble themselves and look out of both lenses gets to see the whole picture. That's where humility comes in. I mean, when it says the fullness of the Gentiles, that doesn't mean quantity. It means maturity. You don't harvest a crop until it's mature. So God is waiting for the Gentiles to grow up. And so, I mean, a lot of ministries are out there trying to save the lost. El Shaddai is trying to mature those who are saved. So they're not still on milk and cookies. They can graduate to meat and potatoes. Now, a Jew would have to be totally blind to accept a blonde-haired, blue-eyed Messiah who abolishes the Torah and whose followers regularly kill Jews in his name. Hello? Okay. What is more, such a statement ignores Christianity's own blindness to the Messiah. Even though we've possessed the Gospels for 2,000 years, Christians are still largely blind to the fact that Jesus is Jewish, and they don't even know his Hebrew name, Yeshua. Amazing. As a matter of fact, Matthew 7, 22 and 23, it says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we prophesied in your name, and in your name cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works? And he's going to say, I never knew you, you that are doing iniquity. What? How can those things be iniquitous? Well, a lot of it is because they're doing those things for their own glory, not for God's glory. Look at Isaiah 42, 19 through 21. It says, who is blind but my servant? Wow. Can you imagine? How would you want to send a messenger 20 miles on a horse to tell somebody something and they were blind? It might take a few days, a few months. Or how would you like to have a servant who is deaf? You know, I mean, this is, and God is saying it's my kids that are blind and deaf. Who is blind as he that is perfect, and blind as the Lord's servant? Now, see, this is going to tie in to the second half that we'll be doing here in a little bit. Seeing many things, but you observe not. Opening the ears, but he hears not. Okay, when you think of seeing many things and observe not, what do you think that means? You can be watching something, and then all of a sudden, oh, that's a robbery taking place. Or, I mean, you can see something going on, but this is an easier one. Hearing. Dump the trash. Did you hear me? What you're saying is, if you hear me, you should respond. But sometimes we can see things, but we don't perceive what is really happening. I'll give you another good example of, and I can do this because I'm a man and I'm a husband. You're watching TV, and your wife comes up and says, "Turn that stupid TV off." So you're okay, and you grab the newspaper. Okay, you hear something, but you don't hear the fact, spend time with me. I'm more important than the TV. I'm more important than the newspaper. So, but it happens both ways. You can see things, but not really know what's going on. We can hear things, but not really understand. Does everybody know what I'm talking about? Okay, and so what, if you can't see something, what do you want to do? You want to magnify it, right? You have a magnifying glass. Some people have a whole sheet to lay it on their page to magnify it because they can't see or they can't hear. They get hearing aids. Well, look at the next verse. It says God is going to magnify the law and make it honorable. He wants to magnify. Because we're not seeing, we're not hearing, God wants to magnify the Torah, magnify the sound so we hear him, magnify the letter so we can read it, because the Torah is what is important. Look at Luke 24, 15 and 16. It says, it happened while they talked, this is Yeshua on the road to Emmaus, that Yeshua himself came near and went with them, but it says their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Wow. And this is what Yeshua did. He has kept the Jewish eyes from recognizing him to this day. You can't blame them for not seeing clearly when God has his hands over their eyes. And you're really going to see that. This second half is going to be amazing as we talk about times and seasons. But we have to realize the Christian's job is to pray that God would remove his hand so they can see completely. That's what it's all about. God blinded Isaac's eyes to accomplish his purposes in bringing forth the Messiah through Jacob. Get a load of this. If Isaac had not been blinded, he would plainly have recognized Esau. And the redemption process would have taken a completely different turn. God wanted the Gentiles to be grafted in. And so you have to understand this perspective. If Israel had not been blinded, what would have happened to the redemption of the Gentiles? This is why we have to understand God's hand is in all of this. As a matter of fact, in Genesis 27, 2 through 4, Isaac says, "Behold, I am old. I don't know the day of my death. Therefore, take, I pray you, your weapons, your quiver, your bow, go out to the field, take me some venison, make me savory food such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat and that my soul may bless you before I die." Okay, so here, Isaac thinks he's going to die. He actually lives another 60 years. But he thinks he's going to die, but he's not going to die. But what's amazing, we know Esau is the gourmet chef. All right, we can see here. Go make me some savory food. And yet, many years earlier, he's telling Jacob he wants to eat some of this cheap, poor food, you know, because he's too tired. If he was that hungry, he could have made the food he liked. Now, here's the thing. How old is Jacob and Esau at this time? Okay, now, here comes Jacob pretending to be Esau. At the first time, it was when Shem died, and they were 50 years old. Now, let's go back to this chart. Isaac thinks he's going to die, and Esau and Jacob are 77 years old when this happens. Oh, Isaac lives another 43 years. So Isaac lives another 43 years. I knew it was a little while. But I just wanted you to see this is happening, and they are 77 years old, Jacob and Esau. And what many of you may not have known, when you see this, where am I? Yeah, Jacob is 97 years old when he wrestles the angel. And he succeeded. Pretty amazing. But let's go back here. Okay. What do we find in Genesis 27, 5 through 10? Rebekah heard when Isaac spoke to Esau. Then what does it say? His son. And Esau went to the field to hunt for venison to bring it. And Rebekah spoke unto Jacob. What does it say? Oh, yeah. You parents know what I mean. When the kid is bad, that's your child. And when they're good, that's my child. And so here we see already this argument. Ah, that's his son. And this is her son over here. And she says, behold, I heard your father speak to Esau, your brother, saying, bring me some great food. And then she said, hearken to my voice according to that which I command you. Go to the flock and fetch me from there two good kids of the goats. I will make them savory food for your father, such as he loves. Bring it to your father that he can eat, so he may bless you before his death. Oh, my goodness. Now, Jacob is scared to death because he thinks, one of the amazing things is that I think not only was Isaac, his eyes were dim, but I almost wonder if he had bad hearing. Because you would think he could tell after 77 years, Jacob's voice from Esau's voice. But let's look at what happens in Genesis 27:15. Rebekah took some goodly raiment of her oldest son, which were with her in the house. Can you imagine? Here she's still taking care of Esau's clothes, and he's 77 years old. Okay. And put them on Jacob, her younger son. Now, here's what is something that is quite amazing, and you want to write this down. This event happened on Passover. What's amazing about this, we know Israel did not recognize Yeshua either as the Messiah. And here, Messiah comes in disguise, bringing the blessing to all of mankind on Passover. And in Genesis 27:19, Jacob is speaking to his dad, and he says, I am Esau, your firstborn. I have done according to what you asked me. Sit and eat of my venison that your soul may bless me. And then look here. He came near and he kissed him and he smelled the smell of raiment and he blessed him. And he said, see, the smell of my son is as the smell of a field, which the Lord has blessed. Therefore, may God give you the what? The dew of heaven always refers to the resurrection of the dead. The dew of heaven always refers to the resurrection of the dead. And if you remember, Abraham told Isaac when he was about to kill him that I believe God is going to raise you, Isaac, from the dead. And so here Isaac is passing that blessing on to Jacob. And then it says, not only that, but the fatness of the earth, plenty of corn and wine, let people serve you, nations bow down to you, be Lord over your, what? Okay, what does that say? How many brothers did he have? He only had one. Or did he have more that's not recorded in the Bible? Think about that. I don't know how many of you ever stopped and look at that. He says to Jacob and Esau, be Lord over your brothers. Well, there's different ways of looking at this. It says, let your mother's what? Sons. Plural. Does that mean there were more sons that they had besides Jacob and Esau? And then it says, let your mother's sons bow down to you. Curse everyone that curses you, and blessed be he that blesses you. Well, what some people say is, in Hebrew, a brother doesn't always mean a literal brother. This could mean their descendants, their Toldot. So I'm not saying there were other brothers or sisters. I'm saying that it looks more like it means all of Esau's descendants. Okay? Now, look at this. In Hebrews 11, verse 20. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning what? Things to come. It wasn't for just that time, but for the future. And this is why the do always refers to the resurrection of the dead. Look at Isaiah chapter 26, verse 19. Your dead men shall live, together with my dead body shall they arise. Awake and sing, you that dwell in the dust, for your dew is as the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead. All right, so in the Song of Songs, if you remember, when the Messiah is knocking on the door, he said, my locks are filled with dew. Okay, so this is referring again to the resurrection of the dead. And then Esau comes in Genesis. This is 27, verse 32 through 34. And Isaac, his father, said to Esau, who are you? And he says, I am your son, your firstborn Esau. And then Isaac starts trembling very exceedingly. And he said, well, who is this that has taken the venison and brought it to me? And I've eaten of all before you even came, and I blessed him. Yea, and he shall be blessed. And when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with an exceeding great and bitter cry and said to his father, bless me, even me also, O my father. Now remember, he's 77 years old. To me, this is just amazing. And what I think is interesting, you're going to see in the next Torah portion, Jacob also is lifting up his voice and crying. It's going to be payback time. But you're going to find that out next week. So with that, let's stand. And we'll close with prayer, and then we're going to come back and talk again about times and seasons. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father, our King, we just thank you so much that your Torah is so alive. Your word is alive. It's meant for us today, for us to learn from. It's always about things to come, not just the past, but the present and the future as well. Father, give us a heart to perceive and to see those things that are hidden from our eyes. And Father, I just pray right now for all of those that are here in this building and for all of those around the United States and around the world, that the light of your Torah would bring life. Light brings life. That you would bring life. You would strengthen everyone at this time, encourage them. Father, we thank you for any of the tithes or donations that come in, because the sole purpose is to magnify your Torah and to give it the honor that you want it to have. In Yeshua's name, amen. Together, blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and king of the universe. You have blessed us with your Torah of truth. You have blessed us with the whole counsel of your living word by the power of your Holy Spirit. Through the completed work of Messiah Yeshua, you alone have planted among us life eternal. Blessed are you, Lord our God. Amen. Take a break. Okay, well, I have some very, 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 exciting teachings coming right now. As you remember, did you guys like the teaching last week on knowing the times and seasons and understanding what the springtime meant and the tribes? So let me bring this little chart up for you. Okay, this is how they were arranged around the temple. And we just covered the eastern side of the tabernacle where Judah was number one, representing the month of Nisan. Then Issachar marched to war, and that's the second month, Iyar. And then Zebulun, the third month, Sivan. So all of those are the spring. So over the next couple of weeks, we're going to cover summer, talking about what the season really means. And so Reuben is the leader. So he goes forth. That's the month of Tammuz. And then Simeon is the month of Av. And then Gad is the month of Elul. And I want to point out, all of those on the east and south are Leah's kids, or Leah's handmaid Bilhah is Gad. And so I just kind of want you to get a good idea. There's a lot of information on there, and we'll cover the west and the north later. But one of the amazing things, what are some of the things that happened in the month of Tammuz? What happened on the 17th day of Tammuz? The golden calf. So Tammuz, we see big disaster, but when did the spies bring the bad report? Do you remember what day and month the spies brought the bad report of the land? The ninth day of the month of Av. So that's the next tribe we're going to study. But today we're sticking with Tammuz. But what I want you to know is it was the entire month of Tammuz that they were spying out the land. They spied the land for 40 days. And so it was the whole month of Tammuz. They're spying or looking at what is going on. What was the problem in the month of Tammuz? What did they see? Giants! Well, the question is, we're going to talk about vision. Tammuz is the month of vision, sight. And the question is, are you seeing giants or are you seeing opportunities? It's all based on your perspective. How many of you are bigger than a hornet or a bumblebee? How many of you don't want to be surrounded by hornets or bumblebees or spiders? Okay, size doesn't always matter. But the problem is they were looking at the giants, not at the opportunity. And so Reuben is the tribe for the month of Tammuz. Who knows what Reuben's name means? Okay, this is why it's the month of vision. Reuben means, look, a son. Ru, or Ra'e, is to see. Ben means son. So the very name Reuben also means to look upon. We see this in Genesis 29, verse 32. Leah conceives, bear a son, and she called his name Reuben, because he said, surely the Lord has what? Looked upon my affliction. Now, therefore, my husband will love me. Okay, so the very name of Reuben means to see. The question is, what is your perspective? What do you see? Now, this is the month of the golden calf. Look at Exodus 32, 4, and 5. Aaron receives the gold from their hand. He fashions it with a graving tool and made a golden calf. And they said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. And when Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And so here they're looking at the golden calf in the month of Tammuz. So I want to bring this out as well. So here what we have, the gemstone for Reuben is the ruby. Okay, that's the gemstone for Reuben. So here we are. We're going to talk about the fourth month, the fourth tribe that marched, the month of Tammuz in the summer, and when they sent the spies, and we have a ruby. Now, what's interesting, what did they build? A golden calf. How many of you have seen this golden calf in the United States on Wall Street? A big golden calf. Well, do you remember the 4th of July, 1776, that was the 17th of Tammuz. The very day we became a nation was on the same day they built the golden calf. Isn't that kind of interesting about the United States? Now, let's look at Numbers 13:22. Here the spies ascended by the south, and they came to Hebron. Where? Look at these guys' names. Ahiman, Shishai, and Tomai, and the children of Anak were. That's where they were. The children of Anak is where you get the word the Anakims. Okay, so we think, wow, Anak, he has these three giants. He must be pretty big. Well, you should see his dad. What was his dad's name? Anybody know what Anak's dad's name? You will never forget it here in a little bit. Okay, first off, I want to show you, let's go to Numbers 13, 25 through 28. Here they return from doing what? Okay, they're looking. They're seeing out the land at the end of 40 days. And they went and they came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel to the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh, brought back word to them and all the congregation. And what did they do? Showed them. Okay, here they're seeing the fruit. And they told them and said, we are come to a land where you sent us, and surely it does flow with milk and honey. Then look how big that fruit is. And then they say, however, the people who dwell in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. Wow. That's what they were looking at. And so they were afraid. Look at Numbers 13, 32 and 33. It says, they brought an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search is a land that eats up the inhabitants, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come up the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. How did they know how they were in their sight? Do you want me to tell you how they were in their sight? Look at this, Joshua chapter 2, verse 9 through 11. It's not on your notes, it's on the screen. Here, this is Rahab, the harlot, 40 years later even. And she said to the men, I know the Lord has given you the land and that your terror is fallen upon us. All the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side of Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt. Neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is the God in heaven above and the earth beneath. That's what they were thinking. These giants were terrified. So here they are, the three sons, Numbers 13, 22, Ahiman, Shishai, and Talmai. And what do we find in Numbers 13, 33? We saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in their sight as grasshoppers. So here they are, seeing themselves as grasshoppers. And they said, and that's what they thought. We were grasshoppers. Well, I think what's fascinating about this, they were seeing with physical eyes the three giants on the earth, but this whole event happened in Hebron. Who is in Hebron? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the three giants in the earth that God had made covenant with. Here, God tells Abraham, your seed will be as the stars. And the very same covenant he gives to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Numbers 14, 9, Joshua and Caleb say, don't rebel against the Lord. Don't fear the people of the land. They are bread. Their defense is departed. The Lord is with us. Don't fear them. So 10 of the spies saw the giants on the earth. Joshua and Caleb saw the spiritual giants in the earth and knew they could trust in God. Here is, and I've seen this. This is where Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are buried in Hebron. And we're going to be going to Hebron on our tour in Israel. Now, let me show you this map. Here in the red, you can see it's Hebron on the top left, and it's kind of this whole area. Now, over here is Kiriath Arba. Kiriath means town or village. This is the town or village of Arba. And this is only less than a half a mile. Okay, the map is big, but it's really close. Now, get a load of this. Down here is the cave of Machpelah, where Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and of course, Google calls it the Abrahami Mosque. So they think it's the mosque. But remember, it's the three children of Anak. Anak's the big guy? No, he's not. Here we go. Joshua 20, 11, and 12. And they gave them the city of Arba, the father of Anak. So Arba is the father of Anak, who's the father of the three giants. And guess what? That's what Caleb inherits, the very place they were terrified. And it says he chased out all the giants. Isn't that amazing? Which is Hebron, in the hill country of Judah, with the suburbs around about it. But the fields of the city, the village thereof, gave they to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, for his possession. When you go with me to Hebron, you're going to be standing at the very spot where the spies encountered the giants. This is what's so fun. This is why I love going to Hebron. Now, here is the tomb of the patriarchs. This is where we go. You come on, see this curvy street here? You come along, the bus parks along here, and then you walk up here and you go into the mosque. You can see up there, Abrahami Mosque. Okay, now here's the thing though. This side of the street is all Muslim. This side of the street is Jewish. And one of the things, if you have heard me speak before, you'll know this, but we had stopped and we tell everybody on the bus, do not go to the Muslim stores. Go to the Jewish stores. There's the nice Jewish stores. There's a nice restaurant. There's places to shop. And we had this 19-year-old girl that decided she wanted to go across the street to the Islamic shops. And big trouble ensued. Big trouble ensued. Yeah, one of the shop owners tried to molest her and slam her against the wall and all this kind of stuff. And so anyway, our whole tour had to sit in Hebron for a whole day while they arrested the guy and interrogated him and took him to Jerusalem. So it ruined the tour that day. But anyway, I've been there over 25 times, and we know things. And when we tell people, please don't go across the street, we mean don't go across the street. Okay. Now, as we're looking here, did you see its sight, its perspective? It's all about what do you see. Everybody sees something different. All of us can look at an event, and we are all going to see it differently. This, as a matter of fact, let me bring up this. And everyone's going to relate. How others perceive us depends on what they see. All of us want to be perceived a certain way. How they perceive us depends on what they see. They do not know what is going on in your head. You may be trying to do something and they're thinking you're doing something bad when actually you're trying to help. How many of you know what I'm talking about? How many of you have been prejudged about something and they had no idea what you were thinking? They perceive one thing. Well, others also perceive us differently than we see ourselves. Isn't that true? Okay. Well, guess what? Let me give you a good example of Jesus versus Yeshua. What do you see? Okay, what? When you speak to people and you talk about Jesus or Yeshua, they have some imagination in their mind. What are they seeing? Another thing is, how do we perceive God? Every single one of us perceive God differently based on our life. We really do. Now, does that make one person's perception wrong and the other perception's wrong, you're going to see this is really interesting, especially when you think of many people are turning to an AI God. Wow, God could be artificial intelligence. Here's a news article. There's an AI Jesus avatar, test man's faith in machines and the divine. In a Catholic parish, they put an avatar Jesus in the confessional, and then people could go in and sit down in the closed door and confess their sins to this AI Jesus, who would respond with biblical verses and let them know they're forgiven. Okay, but this is going there as an AI Buddha God. Okay, there all these gods are turning to AI to make connections, and people can, you know, they can have their own little AI Jesus robot in their house if they want it. Okay, so it all comes down to how do you perceive everything? How many of you know right now with AI, you may see a video of a person and it's not even that person. Can you imagine how that could lead to nuclear war? If all of a sudden someone posts something of a president of a nation saying something and it's not true, and they've got to very quickly try to find out, is this true or not? We are entering an age like never before where vision and what we see, can we trust it or not? Even what you read, even what you hear, it's a mess right now. But look what God said. In Numbers 15, verse 38 and 39, he says, speak to the children of Israel and tell them that they should make themselves fringes. So here's a picture. Here's what they're talking about. The tzitzit on the garments. And it says that they should make fringes in the borders of their garments throughout their generations. They put on the fringe of each border a cord of blue, and it will be a fringe that you may, what? He wants you to see it, and the purpose of seeing it is to remember all the commandments and do them, that you don't follow after your own heart and what? Your own eyes. All through the Bible it says, and Israel did that which was right in their own eyes, not which was right in the eyes of the Lord. Wow. So that is the situation. We all think we can discern good and evil, what is right. Well, in this circumstance, it's okay. But maybe in God's circumstances, it's not okay. So this whole month, Tammuz, is all about what do you see? Look at Numbers 16:14. They're really upset at Moses and Aaron, and they say, moreover, you haven't brought us into a land flowing with milk and honey, nor given us inheritance of fields and vineyards. Are you going to put out the eyes of these men? We won't come up. In other words, what they see is the truth. It may be the truth to them, but it's not the truth as far as reality goes. Look at Numbers 17:8. It happened on the next day that Moses went into the tent of testimony, and behold, what did they see? The rod of Aaron, for the house of Levi was budded, and he put forth buds, produced blossoms, and bore ripe almonds. That is pretty good to have a dead stick bud and produce blossoms and produce almonds overnight, and it wasn't attached to a tree. Okay? And so God is saying, you want to see something, see this. Look at Numbers 21:6-9. Here, the Lord sends fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people. Now, what are you going to think when you're getting bit by a fiery serpent and you're getting hurt? This is bad. This is not good. Okay? And then many people of Israel died. And so they came to Moses and said, we've sinned because we've spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he takes these serpents away. So Moses prays for the people, and the Lord tells Moses, okay, you go make a fiery serpent, set it on a standard, and it'll happen. Everyone who is bitten, when he sees it, shall live. So Moses made a serpent of brass, set it on the standard, and it happened that if a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked to the serpent of brass, he lived. Wow. So that same serpent, they look at and it kills them. They look at it and it heals them. There's two sides, they say, to every coin. Like God tosses the coin. What do you want? Life or death? It's your choice. But it's the same coin. We have to look at everything. Sometimes the thing that we think is the most horrible thing actually is the biggest blessing. And some of the things that we think is the biggest blessing, oh, I just wish I had that 30-foot boat. And it becomes the biggest curse. You know, I'm just telling you. We all look at things differently. In Numbers 22:2, it says, Balak, the son of Zippor, saw what Israel had done to the Amorites. And then in verse 23, the donkey saw the angel standing in the way, and Balaam didn't see. So here, Balaam has one perspective, and his donkey has another perspective. They are both seeing different things. But what happens in verse 31, the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel. And so this is why it's so important. And I don't believe I see everything perfectly. I don't. And which is why I think, well, this is what I think. You know, I don't say this is always the absolute truth unless it's Torah and it's plain that it's truth. I believe, in one sense, every single person was given a piece of the puzzle. And we've got a puzzle box, and you look at the lid, and there's all, I believe everyone has a piece of the puzzle. So I want your piece, and I want your piece, and I want your piece. So when people come, I don't care where they are in life, I try to hear, is there something God is using that person to give me a piece of the puzzle I need? I always look at that. I don't care if it's a homeless person that comes up and talks to me. I believe God brings people into our paths all the time. Who knows? Sometimes it could be an angel unaware. And so for me, I'm always wanting, okay, God, you brought them here, so he must have a piece of the puzzle. Let's see what piece I can find to help round my corners. And so here, in Numbers 25, 6, and 7, one of the children of Israel came and brought to his brothers a Midianite woman in the sight of Moses and in the sight of all the congregation of the children of Israel while they were weeping at the door of the tent of meeting. And then Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, what did he do? He saw what was happening, and he rose up, took a spear in his hand, and he shish kebabbed the couple. Okay? He saw something different than the rest of the people saw. One, and I'm all for prayer. I'm all for prayer. But sometimes someone's got to take action. You can pray all day, but if you just pray and you don't get up and do anything, it doesn't help. What we need to pray for is that God will give us the strength to go do something about it. Look at this. This is in Esther chapter 3, verse 5. Haman saw that Mordecai didn't bow, and Haman was full of wrath. Okay, wow. He perceived something different. He saw Mordecai and he didn't bow. So what happens? We understand sometimes we can falsely perceive things, get all worked up and upset, and react without ever checking into first to see if it's even true. Isaiah 11:3 talks about the Messiah himself. And look what it says about the Messiah. He will not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears. Isn't that interesting? Messiah is going to look at your heart. He's not going to judge this by the sight of his eyes or the hearing of his ear. He's going to judge by your heart. And look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. Eve saw the tree was good for food. It was pleasant to her eyes. Wow, this fruit is great to even look at. And she knows it's good for food, and it's to make one wise. So she took of the fruit and ate, gave also to her husband, what? With her, which means he was standing right there. And then he did eat. And then what happens in verse 7, the eyes of them both were opened and they knew they were naked and sewed fig leaves together and make aprons. First off, this tells you it wasn't an apple tree. It was fig leaves. Apple leaves are much too small anyway to make any apron. But we see it was a fig tree right here. But the thing is, we can look at something and go, wow, that sure looks nice. Oh, and it's good for food. I bet it tastes good, but that doesn't make it good. You got to understand, good is also on the bad tree. Good and evil are on the tree that will kill you. Too often, Christians' question is this good or bad? Sorry, same tree. The question is, does it bring life or death? That is the question. Not good or evil, but life or death. There's sometimes things can happen like that. Wow, we don't want to choose necessarily the good. We want to choose what is going to bring life. Because sometimes you got to realize good is on the same tree as evil. Just something to think about. Okay, so now, here's the thing. This, we're talking about, it says in 2 Kings 25, 1 through 4. It came to pass in the ninth year, this is of King Zedekiah's reign, in the 10th month, the 10th day of the month. Does anyone know what month they're talking about? What month is the 10th month? It's easy to remember. It starts with the letter T. 10th, Tevet. Okay, so the Jews forever have been fasting on the 10th of the 10th month Tevet ever since this event happened. And it says, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, came and all of his host against Jerusalem, and they besieged it. And the city was besieged until the 11th year of King Zedekiah. So King Zedekiah reigned 11 years. The last 2 years of his reign, Babylon has surrounded Jerusalem. And then it says, on the ninth day of the fourth month, the famine prevailed in the city and there was no bread. Okay, the ninth day of the fourth month. What is the fourth month? The fourth month? We just got on talking about it. Tammuz! That's the one we're in. We did the three tribes on the east. We're now starting the south. So we see in Tammuz is the fourth month, okay? So in the 10th month, Tevet, they besieged it. And because they besieged it, several months later, in the fourth month, they've run out of food. They've run out of bread because it's been besieged. They can't go out and get anything, all right? Jeremiah talks about this day in chapter 52, verse 6 and 7. It says, in the fourth month, Tammuz, the ninth day of Tammuz, the famine was sore in the city. There was no bread for the people. The city was broken up. All the men of the war fled. Now remember, it says in the verse before, it was besieged to the 11th year. So Jeremiah 52 is talking about the 11th year. And he says that, which was by the king's garden, but the Chaldeans were surrounded the city and they went by the way of the plain. Okay, we see in the fourth month, the month of Tammuz, on the ninth day, the city was broken up. People were fleeing. Well, what's amazing about the 17th of Tammuz, the very day they worshiped the golden calf, it was a week or two later that the walls of Jerusalem were broken through by Nebuchadnezzar. So the same day, the 17th of Tammuz, they worshiped the golden calf. Now, thousands of years later, it's on the very same day, the walls are broken down and they get besieged. Now, so this happens in, also, it was on the 17th of Tammuz in 70 AD that the walls were breached by the Romans. Same day. Now, this month of Tammuz is all about what? Vision, seeing, sight. Look what happens in the month of Tammuz. In 2 Kings 25, 6, and 7, King Zedekiah is fleeing. And it says they took the king and brought him up to the king of Babylon, to Riblah. And they gave judgment upon him. And they slew the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes and then poked out his eyes. So the last thing he would see is the death of his sons. Now, the beginning is Reuben, see a son. And it ends with Zedekiah not seeing a son. And it's the last thing he sees before his eyes are put out. And this happens in the month of Tammuz. Vision or no vision? And then what do we see in Ezekiel 1, 1 through 3? It came to pass in the 30th year, in the fourth month. And what's the fourth month? Tammuz. On the fifth day of the month, here Ezekiel is in Babylon. He was among the captives by the river of Chebar. The heavens were opened and he sees a vision. Isn't that interesting? Tammuz is the month of vision. And it's in Tammuz, Ezekiel has a vision of God. And it was on the fifth day of the month, which was the fifth year of King Jehoiakim's captivity, and the word of the Lord came expressly to Ezekiel the priest. So again, Tammuz is a month for visions. Are we going to see correctly, or are we not going to see correctly? Now, look at Zechariah 8:19. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the fast of the fourth month. What is the fast of the fourth month? The 17th of Tammuz, when they worshiped the golden calf. So if unless you know that, you're not going to know what they're talking about. The fast of the fourth month is the day they worshiped the golden calf. And now they're fasting thousands of years later because it's the same day that the walls were broken down. And then it says the fast of the fifth month. What is the fast of the fifth month? The ninth of Av, when the temple was destroyed. And then it says the fast of the 10th month. What's the fast of the 10th month? We just talked about the 10th of Tevet, the very day Israel, Jerusalem, was besieged by Nebuchadnezzar. So all of these are tied to the destruction of the temple. Oh, and it talks about the fast of the 7th month. What month is the 7th month? Tishri. Okay, what happens on the 2nd of Tishri after Rosh Hashanah is when the people of the land killed the governor that Nebuchadnezzar had put in charge, Gedaliah, and they kill him. So unless, I mean, a lot of people are into prophecy. Oh, we're into prophecy. Well, guess what? If you're not on God's calendar and you don't understand these fast days, this is a prophecy because it's saying these four fast days are going to turn for Judah to be houses of joy and gladness, cheerful feasts, therefore love, the truth, and peace. Wow. So I just gave you four fast days that are all that happened around 580 BC. Based on events that happened in 1500 BC. Patterns repeat. And so all of these fast days, the fathers had done something horrible on those days, which is why these horrible events of the destruction of the temple all took place on those same days. But if you claim to be a prophet or know prophecy, but you're not attached to the biblical calendar, you will never know when this prophecy is fulfilled. Therefore, on these days every year, I look forward to see if the prophecy will be fulfilled on those days. But if you don't know when those days are on the calendar, you definitely won't know it on the Gregorian calendar. You won't know when prophecy is fulfilled. So if you want to be in the prophetic movement, and not the pathetic movement, you need to be on God's calendar. Okay, look at this. Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. But he who keeps the law, happy is he. Wow. What is that saying? No Torah, no vision. No Torah and No vision. Perspective. Look at Lamentations 2:9. Her gates are sunk into the ground. He's destroyed and broken her bars. This is Jeremiah lamenting the destruction of Jerusalem. Her kings and princes are among the Gentiles. The law is no more. Her prophets find what? Wow. No Torah, no vision. This is why, this is one of my favorite little pictures here. Proverbs 6:23, the commandment is a lamp and the Torah is the light. So like these ancient little vessels, the word mitzvot, does anyone know what mitzvot means? Commandments. The commandments are the lamp holding the oil of the Spirit that produces the light, which is the Torah. So here's what we need to understand. Doing the commandments is what fuels the light in the darkness. We don't do works to get saved. We do works because Dad said, would you go do this for me? Look at Matthew 5:16. Let your light so shine before men that they may what? See, the month of Tammuz, see your good works, but glorify who? Your Father, which is in heaven. The problem is, so many people do good works to see, look how good I am. Look what I've donated to society. I need a bridge named after me. I need a building named after me. I need a city named after me, a street named after me. It's all about me. Okay? When God says, I don't know you, to believers, it's believers who are doing good works for their own glory, not for his glory. Jews do not think they get saved by works. They never did. They've always thought of themselves as already in the family. They don't need to do something to get in the family. The reason why they do the mitzvot is because they believe they're in a family. Let me give you a good example. How many of you have ever been to Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts? Okay, I was. Well, sometimes, let's say I go to the Boy Scouts and they want me to build a rocket. And I'm having fun building a rocket, and my neighbor who's not in the Boy Scouts, that's my age, thinks that's really cool. So he goes, gets a rocket, and we both build the rocket together. We're both working. We're both building the rocket. Who gets the merit badge? I do, because I'm in the Boy Scouts. Does he get a merit badge? Why? He's not in the Boy Scouts. Now, do I build a rocket so I can get into the Boy Scouts? No. I build a rocket because I'm in the Boy Scouts. Well, it's the same thing with the Bible, for heaven's sakes. We don't do works to get into the kingdom. We work because that's part of the kingdom, how God wants us to behave. I hope that makes sense. Okay. Now, I think, well, I'm going to have you guys look at a screen. But I don't want anybody to say anything. I want you just to look. We're going to see everyone's perspective. Does anybody see, if you see numbers, if anyone sees numbers, raise your hand. If you don't see a number, raise your hand. If you don't see a number, okay, this is a color vision test. Okay, this is just a normal test. Now, some people will see the numbers, like 8, 6, 29, 3, 15, 74. Now, you see that, but a colorblind person doesn't see it, right? You both are looking at the same thing, but you see something different. Who's right and who's wrong? The other person can't see it. And this is why I don't get in arguments with people over the Bible, because if they don't see it, why argue? I don't argue with the blind person over a work of art. I don't argue with a deaf person over a piece of music. So too many people, they're so proud and I'm right, you're wrong, they get in these big fights not realizing the other person can't see it. So you got to pray that God would open their eyes so they do see it. For example, what do you see here? What do you see? Do you see the word Zion in English? Okay, I see a letter Z, a letter I, a letter O, a letter N. I see, looks like water, some sun rays. Now, when a Jew who knows English and Hebrew sees Zion, here's what they see. They see the Hebrew letters, okay, the Tzad, the Yud, the Bav, and the Nun. Are both correct? Well, guess what? When I see Zion, do you know what I see? The first letter of Zadeh that David used when he came up with the word Zion means a fish hook. And he drew, this was the font. It was a fish hook. Remember the Lord said he wanted to make us fishers of men? And he said, if I be lifted up, you'll catch all men? The last letter is where we got our end from in Hebrew, and it was a fish darting through water. So when I see the word Zion, I see catching fish. And what's the bait on the hook to catch the fish? The middle two letters are the Yud and the Vav, which is a hand and a nail, and the nailed hand of the Messiah is the bait on the hook to catch the fish. So when I see Zion, I see a prophecy from 1,000 years before Messiah came. So everyone is at a different place, and they see things differently. Here, look at this. What do you see in this picture? You see clouds, the moon, the ocean. You see stars. Okay? You know what I see? I see stars. And I think it says in Exodus 32, remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants to whom you swore by your own self and said to him, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven and all this land that I've spoken, I will give to your seed and they will inherit forever. Wow, when I see the stars, I think of God's covenant to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob for the land of Israel. How about when I see the moon? When I see the moon, I don't see the moon. I see Psalm 89 where God says, once I've sworn by my holiness, I won't lie to David, and his seed will endure forever. His throne as the sun, it will be established forever as the moon, as a faithful witness in heaven. So when I see the moon, I think of the covenant of David. When I see the stars, I think of the covenant to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. When I see the waters, I see Habakkuk 2:14, where the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Everyone is going to see something different when they see, depending on where they are at in life. What do you see? I love pointing out the stars to people and telling people, the Jews aren't going away, guys. Or pointing at the moon, or pointing at the sun. And so here, in Mark 8:22-25, Yeshua came to Bethsaida, and they brought a blind man and besought the Lord to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand, led him out of the town. And when the Lord had spit in his eyes and put his hands on him, he asked him if he saw. And he looked up and said, I see men as trees walking. So he put his hands again on his eyes and made him look up. And he was restored and saw every man clearly. Sometimes we don't see clearly. We may see, but we're not seeing clearly. This is why 1 Corinthians 13:12, we see through a glass darkly, we only know in part. Romans 11:25, Israel was only blinded in part. Revelation 3:17, the Laodicean church is blind. So many people, they misunderstand the verse where Yeshua says, I'm standing at the door knocking, and use it as a salvation message. He's knocking at the door of the church, and they don't even know he's left. They don't even know he's outside. They're saying, leave me alone. We're having church here. 1 John 2:9-11. Whoever's in the light and hates his brother is in darkness. What is the cause of blindness? Look at this. It says this. He that hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness, doesn't know where he's going because that darkness has what? Blinded his eyes. Look at 2 Peter 1:5-9. Besides this, give all diligence, add to your faith virtue, knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, and charity. It says, if these things are in you and abound, they will make sure that you are not barren or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord. Whoever lacks these things is what? If you can't see, it may be because you're lacking these things and you need to have glasses or corrected vision. Look at Isaiah 6:9. And he said, go and tell these people. Hear indeed, but understand. See indeed, but don't perceive. A lot of people see things, but they don't understand what they're seeing. 2 Kings 6:15-17, here we see a servant of the man of God got up early and went, and behold, there was a host compassing the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, "My master, what are we going to do?" And he said, "Don't fear. They that are with us are more than they that are with them." And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray you, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened his eyes of the young man, and he saw the mountains was full of horses and chariots and fire around Elisha. So many people are full of fear when it comes to the tribulation. Get me out of here. I don't want to die. Guess what? We're all going to die. You know, I'm not afraid. I really am, like I said so many times, I'm almost died 10 times. And it's like, hey, if it's not my time, it's not going to happen. If it is my time, there's nothing I can do about it. And so I just don't want to die hiding behind a rock, you know. But we need to realize it is always, there are more with us than there are with them. Let's see. I'm going to jump some things here. James 1:6-8, it talks about we need to ask in faith with nothing wavering. Whoever wavers is like the wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Don't let that man think he'll receive anything. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. That's the problem with Reuben. Reuben was double-minded. He even laid with his father's concubine. Okay, so the month of Tammuz is a month of vision or perception. Are we going to see correctly from God, or are we going to judge everything by our own eyes? And so let me close with this here. So the month of Tammuz, which is roughly our June and July, is a month of vision or perception. It's a month for testing our faith with like the golden calf. It's doing what is right in our own eyes, or are we going to do what is right in God's eyes? So this is the season, the time in the seasons of June, July, Tammuz, is when God is going to be giving us visions, and we're either going to see them or not. But let me explain one thing here as I close. Genesis 49:3-4 talks about Reuben going up to his father's couch. But look at James. We just got done reading about a double-minded man as unstable as on his ways. Let's think about it. Moses, 40 years in the wilderness. Moses had the hardest job on planet Earth. He had to lead an unruly group of people that God himself described as stiff-necked. We've talked about the Jewish people's greatest strength and their greatest weakness. What's their greatest strength? They're stiff-necked. Because we get a hold of Torah and they're not ever going to let go. But their greatest weakness is also being stiff-necked. Because if they don't have Torah, it's hard to get them to get back to Torah. Their complete dedication to an idea which enables them to exist for the last 2,000 years. That's why they're still here. After 2,000 years and die for an ideology that would change the world. What's their greatest weakness? This national characteristic of idealism and independence is a double-edged sword. It has a negative side to it as well. If someone came at me with a knife, it depends. Is it the doctor trying to take out my appendix and save me? Or is it someone who wants to kill me? Okay, perspective. It says, the Jewish people's complete stubborn dedication to an idea is what makes every Jew think he's always right. And every Jew think he is the one who's going to change the world his way. This is a group that is very, very difficult to unify. Look what's happening in Israel right now. And almost impossible to lead. And it's this one Jewish person said, it is far easier to be the premier of a billion Chinese than to be the prime minister of a few million Jews. Now, this is what a Jewish man said, and we'll finish with this. There's a humorous story illustrating this point. It's told about a meeting between President Harry Truman and the future prime minister of Israel, Golda Meir. Truman was bemoaning the difficulties of leadership and a remark to Golda Meir, "You have no idea what it is to be a president of a country of 200 million people." To which Golda Meir responded, You have no idea what it is to be a prime minister of a country of 2 million more prime ministers. In every army in the world, the officers give orders, but in the Israel army, the officers have to explain things. But anyway, so I just want to give you a little bit of idea of perspective. We all may need our perspective adjusted, okay? And we can't do what's right in our own eyes, but what is right in God's eyes. So that's the beginning of the summer season. We'll look at the rest next week. Let's stand. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father King, we just thank you so much for all of those who want to magnify your Torah, who want to make it honorable once again and realize that your word is always true. It is yesterday, today, and forever. May we all glean understanding and insights from your word. And we thank